Good evening and welcome to the Deerfield Sewer Study Committee meeting on Monday. It's not Monday. Thursday, August 25th. Need to change it. That's all right. That's what I get for reading. At 6 p.m. here at the town offices at 8 Conway Road in South Deerfield. So did we have a chance to review the minutes from the last meeting? Anybody else?
Four sets of minutes. Need to approve or review and approve. We have July 20th, July 25th, 28th, and August 7th. We should have a copy of. I think Bob, you were at the August 2nd meeting and...
But I wasn't on the board then, was I?
August 2nd? I think...
I was on...
You were on by August 2nd.
Was I?
Yeah.
Oh, all right.
You were actually on for August 2nd.
Okay.
So the 20th and 25th.
Hi, Kevin.
Bruce, do you have a copy of August?
I got all of them, but August. That's the one I don't have.
Thank you.
There should be a full set.
Yep.
Oh, I just grabbed it.
Unless it's stuck together.
Is it?
Let me see. Oh, I'm sorry.
Let me give those to Kevin.
Kevin?
Yeah. So there have been emails.
Yeah.
Can you take them one by one if you want?
I read most of them. I think I read them all. Does anyone want time to look them over or?
Is everybody a chance?
Yeah, it'd be a good idea to look them over.
Okay.
So we're looking at July 20th first?
Mm-hmm.
We discussed these at our last meeting. There were some changes that were made.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So the first item, we have five people here tonight that were at the meeting. Jack, John is not here tonight. Jeff, myself, John Couture, and Henry Moser.
So everyone finished with those? I make a motion that we accept the minutes as written.
I'll second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 I'm going to abstain because I wasn't there.
Right.
Two extensions. Five in the middle. Yes.
I have a question. There's a reference to Jane Pat. Who's Jane Pat?
We changed that.
Oh, okay. Who was that, John Parr or John?
That was, which word page you on?
Three.
John Pachurk.
John Pachurk.
And on all those?
Yes, we have all those changes.
Okay. Thank you.
The second meeting, we had one, two, three, four, five, six people again. Same six. John's the one here, so.
So I have a question about the rate study.
On the 25th?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or the second? Is that the second?
On the second.
Oh, yeah.
Who's the presentation?
The Prickett.
Oh, we're still on the 25th.
Oh, we're still on what?
We're on the 25th.
We're still doing minutes?
Yeah.
On the 25th, minutes.
Oh, because we never approved those? I'm sorry.
No.
We got the 25th, the 28th, and then the second.
Everybody set with the 25th?
I am.
Make a motion to second the 25th minute.
I'll second it. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Abstain.
5-0-0-2.
Now we'll do the 28th.
Would like to make comment on that if possible?
Sure.
Yes.
There was a discussion about who makes determination of potential sewer users. RD State assessors have that on their property cards. DH has their updating of DAS or data response, yes, with the assessor triennial review of property evaluation. Problem being is those cards are not necessarily always right. Plus, the triennial evaluations, there's only about 10% entrance into the buildings. So it's really not being updated.
Well, that was our concern. Whether we had good data.
And that is not part and parcel of what they're inspecting for anyway.
And that's what was typically used in the rate study.
Right, and that was just a comment on those 25th meeting.
Yeah,
you evidently had that discussion.
Right, that's correct.
Yeah, there's, on majority of this, there's going to be further discussion.
Right.
This is just a preliminary in what we've discussed.
A lot of things to put on.
Basically just accepting as minutes, but not approving anything by any stretch of imagination. There's going to be definitely further discussion on all of this.
All right.
7/28, we had the same, excuse me, July 28th, they had the same five, one, two, three, four. They only had five people that night.
Because this was at the old Deerfield.
At the old Deerfield plant.
The old Deerfield treatment plant. So we had five people make the visit. There's a note from that plant.
Right.
Site visit. They have been reviewed by Keith, who reviewed those. So unless there's any changes or additions.
There's only four of us here tonight with that, so.
So you're going to pass over them? Is that what you want to do?
No, you can still pass them.
Yeah.
Everybody doesn't have to be there. You have to have more than 50% vote.
Yep.
That's it.
I'll make the motion. I was there.
Yep.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We just got August 2nd to go.
These, everybody that is on the committee is here, except for John. It's my understanding that Paul is not going to be on the committee. Is that correct?
Correct, yes.
So that will go into these, this meeting minutes. Carry him as a committee member, but I know he was worried we couldn't attend. We would like to have input if he could come to the 25th.
Paul, yes, and he is willing to do that.
He also said that if we needed some help at the university to reach out to him, that he would be willing to, you know, guide us through that as well.
Guide us to the appropriate department heads and whatever.
So here we had one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight members, which is our full staff. These meeting minutes are very long and very complicated. During the rate study. Items in here that might need tweaking. But I did my best to at least get the flavor of the meeting. There was a lot of things said that probably didn't get noted. It is on tape though. So I will note on the meeting minutes that it is taped, it was taped, in case anybody would like to review. And the public would like to review.
What was the, under Section 2, actions, votes, down at the bottom, Doug Finn questioned whether the town could increase rates to accommodate for unexpected expenses, and he was going to check with town council.
Yeah, I actually spoke to him today about it.
What exactly was the issue? I don't...
The issue was potential for the...
Potential.
Increase in hauling costs for sludge. There was a discussion about potential being three or four times as much as the cost currently.
But since the rates hadn't been, we hadn't set the rates for fiscal '17 yet...
I know.
Then why couldn't you set the rate based on whatever the additional expected costs were?
I think so, too.
My memory recall, the discussion was more so, since the capital needs were going to be coming in so high in the next few years, was starting this year with setting rates higher than was necessary to start putting in money into the capital fund.
Right, that's right.
And whether this could be, you know, governed by the same rules you have to do with town budgets and so forth.
That's right, that was the issue.
That was the additional issue.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
I'll add that, it's also capital needs issue relative to whether we could add additional funds to build...
Beyond the operating costs of the...
Beyond the operating. And there was always, there was discussion later in the minute, in the meeting minutes, relative to how much we have in reserves. So we do have a reserve or something. The idea was that we have 1 year's operating on him.
That's what we've always tried to maintain.
Always tried to maintain. So, and that's further in the...
And it was low this year, and the reason it was because they spent $400,000 putting a new line in old Deerfield.
And they spent $100,000 on the headwork, plus $3,000, $4,000, $5,000. So, I mean, I think, yes, adding that to that discussion is correct. But there is a further discussion in the minutes relative to that item.
Kevin?
Yes.
And I could be wrong here, but I thought part of that, why he wanted to check with council, was because of how the account is set up, the style of what it is, and it's not a true enterprise fund. So technically, it's being, and again, I could be wrong here, but it's being treated as a nonprofit, and if, depending on how you raise the rates compared to the rates compared to what your cost were, your O&M, was going to be more, obviously, for capital, but because of how it was set up, now it looks like it's a for-profit. I think that's what he was concerned about, and that's why he was looking at town council. I mean, because like you said, otherwise, it's just a kind of a no-brainer. This is what it is, this is what it's going to cost, this is where we need to be.
And we have further discussions, too, that we're pretty well determining the rate after the fact.
Exactly, you know, and that's...
So that was part of the reason why we thought, if determining a rate after the fact, we should look at what the cost was. But the nonprofit thing, I don't remember, but that's a problem.
I don't remember that either.
But it does make some sense, right? I think that, I tried to figure out how this, the user's fees are just set up as a user's fee account, and there's no enterprise fund, which I think there needs to be.
Going forward, probably a good idea.
I'm not so sure an enterprise fund is good, because we've got experience 2 years' worth already with South County EMS, and that is not a well-run fund as far as I'm concerned.
Well, there's a difference between what type of fund it is in your...
Yeah, in the operation, the people behind it as well.
No offense, but we can't. That's apples for pineapples.
Yeah, we can have that later in discussion, I think.
But wasn't the issue that the town meeting had authorized revenues of X hundred thousand dollars?
That's another issue that...
to operate the sewage treatment plants.
Right.
And therefore, you couldn't increase the rates beyond that because it wasn't authorized by the town meeting.
Well, actually, what happened, I did a handout for this.
Okay.
The reason I did it, because when I went to look at what Kevin passed out at the end of our meeting, last meeting, numbers didn't match.
Okay.
The budget that was approved was $672,611. And I believe what was handed out was a different number that I have here, but then it was a surplus of $19,000, potential surplus at the end of that fiscal year. But I think it was less than the number you showed. We can get into this in a later day.
Yeah.
Business.
Because I mean, I didn't bring any of my packets with me.
But I would like to discuss.
Yeah, no, not wrong. I mean, basically, what you got there is what I get from.
Yeah, I realize that, but I just wanted, there's a carryover of the, because you had 2 years and both years showed a surplus.
Well, those will always go back into the fund.
Coffers. Right. Into the fund?
Into the fund.
Sewer.
Correct.
Nothing closes out to the town. It all stays in the sewer thing.
Right.
So maybe that's the difference in the two numbers?
Could very well be. Again, without having my information from you.
So if everybody's had a chance to review, we can still talk about, you know, topics on that, but I'd like to approve the minutes from August 2nd. Anyone has any objections, I make a motion that we accept the minutes as they are.
And I did a revision for the capital needs addition.
Okay.
Under the discussion.
All right. Other than that, do I have a second?
I'll second them with the revision.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Yes.
Okay, where do you want to start up about discussion on the sewer rate?
Well, I guess you could start with my question. This comes back to my question that, which I asked Dave Prickett, and he actually changed from the draft. He changed it slightly, and this is on page 5 of the draft memorandum.
I got the first one.
And
the
he talks about,
yes,
down at the bottom, the last paragraph, after meeting with Deerfield several times, et cetera, alternative one was developed. The alternative was honed using the budget projections summarized in table 3.5, et cetera. The resulting wastewater rate of $15.40 per 1,000 gallons with a minimum fee of $100 was developed. However, this more than doubled the current rate, and town staff, who is unnamed, was concerned with the potential of such a sharp rate increase. Therefore, he did an alternative based on $9.74. And I guess my question is that if we spent $10,000 to hire him to do a study, why would we try to quarterback it? Why wouldn't we let him do the study? And if you look at the rest of the numbers here, really we need a rate of $15 plus to cover the potential debt service for the improvements that are proposed. So what I would like to see is, I think it is unreasonable to make an increase that large in 1 year, but I think over 3 or 4 years we should have a plan to bring it up to that rate, and that's going to result in an average bill of about $1,000 a year. So anyway,
to get to part of your question, I think I understand the beginning of your question about, you know, why would we pay somebody all this money and not do it? I mean, obviously this person knows a lot more about this than I do. And, you know, I definitely would take his recommendations, but I still think that it's good for us locally to discuss it and mm-hmm. try to figure out where it comes from. you know, my short experience involved in town government, we've paid a lot of other engineers and consultants an awful lot of money. They've really screwed up really bad.
No, I agree.
And so that's, I'd like to, you know, look at it and talk about it. I mean,
but I'm not faulting anyone. I understand the reason for it and the concern for the ratepayers who we're going to be faced with.
Yes.
But you know, how else are these improvements going to be paid for this vital infrastructure in our town? And I think it's going to be important for someone to take leadership and educate the sewer users as to why their bills are going to increase so drastically.
I don't know. Our, like the Headworks project, where you know there are grants available, are there other grants out there, either through state or federal agencies, to help small communities improve their infrastructure?
There are. I handed out a packet one of our first meetings. USDA is one, but we have to get the rates up.
Yeah, and the rate...
1% and 2%.
The rate has to go up to 1% of median income, right, which is like $66,000 now. So I think that's like $670 or something like that. The rate has to go up to
where is it?
Right. It's 400 something roughly. Average, roughly. Right.
Now, when you say, I'm confused. The rate has to go to 600 or just what the billing is?
The USDA rules, and it says this somewhere in here.
Yeah. Okay.
The USDA rules state that in order to qualify for a town to qualify for a USDA grant, mm-hmm, their current sewer rates have to be 1% of the median income in the town. And so the median income is 66,000, I believe.
Okay.
That's median or the average?
That's the median.
That is the median.
So that would mean that in order to qualify for the USDA grant, the rates would have to go up to like $666 a year.
I think
from 400 something.
Per 1,000 gallons.
Right.
That's where the issue is.
That's what I was getting at.
Total bill.
So
my understanding.
But if the average bill now is $400, right, and that there, what you described is that the average bill has to get to $660.
Right.
Okay. So that if our current rate is $6, then we might have to raise it to $7 to accomplish that.
Actually,
or whatever
more.
But
a lot more.
That's how we do it.
974, probably right.
But you're not talking about the six-month bill. You're talking about the annual bill.
Annual bill. Yeah.
Because, you know, you'll probably find that it's a lot closer than you think it is.
I think it says the average is under $500.
I don't know. You ought to see mine. $600 for 6 months.
No, but we're talking the average, so.
I mean, there was a number put out where we fell. I think it's in the minutes. August 2nd. I think it was 0.7%, 0.06% relative needed to be one.
So it's going to go up by a third.
Was below what needed to be by like 0.04%.
So what you're saying is it's got to go up by at least a third so that we can qualify for the grant.
That would be one option. And there's other options.
That would be a USDA grant.
That's USDA. Then
that's a grant or a loan?
That's
loan,
a grant.
Combination potential. Could be a loan grant up to 25% for a town of our size. 25% grant, 75% loan. State revolving fund is strictly a loan, and that's another option. That's what was used in the study. And to get whatever the improvements were, we were at a rate of $40 and change per 1,000 gallons.
No, as they pointed out here, one thing that they said several times was that the sewer rate has been artificially low for years in Deerfield. But my concern is that we're still talking rates and that. Have we really determined yet what our expenses are truly going to be? Are we accepting that we're supposed to be spending $32 million, and we still don't know, as far as my understanding, we don't know if we're keeping the old Deerfield plant online, if we're decommissioning it.
Right.
We don't know if we're running sewer line down 5 and 10. We do know that there's some needs, obviously, in both areas, but should we not try to define what direction we want to go here to help us set this sewer rate? I mean, to me, trying to set a sewer rate without knowing exactly what's going to be done here, it's like trying to hit a moving target. And I don't know if you truly can do that.
Well, we know, though, that the cost is going to be astronomical. And
yes.
We know that the current rates are not going to cut it.
Right. And so, I do understand we could at least take a step to set next year's rate. I mean, that makes sense. There's no question about it. But down the road, you know, here we are trying to project that it's going to be 15 a thousand or, you know, 20 or 40 or whatever.
Well, he's talking about in here a rate of $40.
I know, that's
in like,
what, that's
in like
what
2025.
Saying.
So, I mean.
But have we truly defined, though, what we need to do as a town and what we want to do as a town as far as the plants? You know, and obviously the headwork project needs to be done. There's no question about that. But
within the next few months,
take
we'll
a look
know
at what
that.
Montague's doing in that.
Yeah.
You know, is a situation where we try to, as a committee, try to hit some timelines here to take that into account too. Is that even an option for Deerfield? If it is, you know, and you know, depending on the state, do we start questioning the state with Montague and saying, you know, look, here we are in line and we need to do something with our systems. We need some help here. We need some answers and maybe try to prod the state along a little bit. Mm-hmm. Because it would be great if we didn't have to rely on trucking out our sludge in that all the time. If there's a system out there that we can eliminate that expense in the long run, would we be better off doing something like that? So to me, it seems like I understand that in the near future, we probably have to do something with the rate. But I also think that we need to really take a look at how we, as Deerfield, where's our ending?
Right.
You know, what do we want as an end? Do we want to get rid of the old Deerfield plant, just the South Deerfield plant? Do we attach to the method that Montague is trying to develop here and jump on that bandwagon in the next year and a half and keep both plants open and don't worry about running the sewer lines down 5 and 10? You know, I read in reports about, you know, the development, you know, industrial and so on and so forth. But if I remember correctly, it wasn't too long ago, too many years ago, nobody wanted to touch 5 and 10. The residents of Deerfield were adamant against developing 5 and 10. So how can we talk about going through the expense of running a sewer line from old Deerfield all the way down to the South Deerfield plant when you have people in town, you know, basically that shut it down before? Maybe it's different now. Maybe there's a different opinion.
And it's basically for one user. Two-thirds
right.
of that flow is one user, right? It's Deerfield Academy, you said.
One-third.
How much of the flow into... Didn't you say that two-thirds of the flow into...
Is from three schools.
Is from the three schools.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So those are major
considerations that we have to... That we have to take a look at, because I think that will affect our overall cost. You know, we do have a $32 million price tag on it. We know it's going to be expensive. We know we have to do something with it, but I think we really need to, you know, Kevin obviously, you know, guys have put in a lot of time, and you know the plant better than anybody, but I think what we need to do is actually figure out what we need to do as a town.
Well, I have the question is to, have we looked at breaking into two districts? One, it's operated by a new entity called the South Deerfield Sewerage Treatment District, and the other one, the Old Deerfield Sewerage Treatment District, and keeping, they pay their expenses, they have their own fees, and what would be, because the numbers are different, vastly different as to the number of rate payers, et cetera. And it might be fairer overall to have a separate district for the village of Old Deerfield and taking care of their needs and a separate district down here. I don't know. I'm just saying, I'm throwing it on the table because, well, you've got, I think if they've got 75 or 80% is the schools in Old Deerfield, and we just spent $400,000 fixing a line up there, right? And those costs are, am I correct? Did you mention that tonight? That's a lot of money for the rest of the ratepayers to pay that's specifically done for the benefit of a small number of users. And, you know, you got to look at, maybe it's, that's too late now, but looking forward, maybe if you have a separate district, and you might have vastly different rates. And, you know.
I think that's something to explore, because the rate structure, to me, the rate structure in Old Deerfield should be different than in the rest of
that. That's my point, is I think that you'll probably find the expenses up there about 15% to 20% of the operating expenses, but you've got a $400,000 item specifically to that plant, that really throws the cost way up.
Kevin.
Actually, I'd like to kind of back up a little bit. What I'm trying to do is I understand completely, we have to look at the whole big picture. Right. There's definitely no doubt about it. But I think as a time crunch, quote unquote, I mean, because realistically, we've got another, month and a half before you're going to set the rate.
What?
This committee is not going to set it.
But they're going to make a recommendation to, they're not even making a recommendation to the
select board. I think we already said what we wanted. Take the same rate you have now and follow the recommendation that they said and go up some.
Right.
Because I can guarantee you that once they get the first bill, you're going to have 30, 40, 50 people in here complaining about that rate.
Right. Oh, guaranteed.
Because it's happened to me.
Right. Oh, I understand. Like I said, I understand completely. But, again, I'm trying to go back to what Jeff was saying. You know, we do have to look at the whole big picture. You know, does all of this in here include, you know, the running down 5 and 10, the pump stations, the whole 9 years? I do not believe so. You know, this is basically what you have in here is what it's going to take to run your next few plants. And if you were to presently keep both of your plants right now, what is it going to take to get to that point, to your O&M and your capital? So, and trying to catch up a little bit further into the conversation, I'm sorry, but actually if you look at table 3-5A, which is the budget projection for current year and fiscal FY17, it basically is a 43% increase. Can some of that be reduced? Yes, it certainly can. Some of this can. Mm-hmm. Some of this is we have to do
right.
An INI study. Done. The INI study has to be done
right.
by December 31st, 2017.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not going to be cheap. Because the last time they did that one, they had to go through and physically look at every single manhole. They had to look at this. They had to look at that. I mean, we are in the process of getting through that. But by the time you get done, I'm not going to throw a number at it, because as soon as I do, I'm going to stop that number. But it's not going to be cheap. And we need to make sure that we are going to be prepared to continue. You know, really, I mean, sitting around here, there's three of us here, and I'm included, that they're actual rate payers. So when I'm saying, you know, we need to raise the rate, it's not a deal of us just saying it as a committee. You know, it's people that are actually affected by it, and other people that are watching this have to understand that, you know, we're doing the best we can for the people, and not just jam something down their throat. Because that's a little bit of what I've gotten for information back. I'm like, what are you doing? It's like, I'm a taxpayer too, one. I'm a ratepayer, and we're trying to do what we need to do to get us through. This is what we need to do. So to go a little bit, and I forgot what my fast forward was. But anyway, so what I'm, like I said, what I'm really concerned about is we need to pay attention to this. Again, I think what Jack says, you know, we probably ought to go up to the 9, because again, if you try and whack everything all at once, it's not going to be pretty whatsoever. But there are a lot of things that are talked about, the $32 million part, that are not part of this, this projection. Yeah. So when you're looking at 2025 going up to $40, that I don't believe that includes, does it?
Yes, yeah, it includes,
it includes the pump stations?
Yes, including all the improvements that were discussed. And it was an SRF loan too.
Okay.
So it included all that.
All right.
Question on this 5A, this transportation and disposal of the sludge for $95,000, is that at the rate you've been paying or the rate you talked about it being tripled?
I have a handout for that.
But the rates just did go up. What did they?
The solid went up $100, right? Went to 350.
Well, it went up more than that because the gallon, the price per gallon was up, and there was an increase. I don't know what that fee for $250 and went to $350. I don't know if that was.
That's the dryer, the solids, I think, right? When they get rid of the sludge, there's your liquid fee, and then there's your solid fee.
I have a handout based on.
What is the question? I've lost track.
My first question was in this 5A. Reference there for your budget for 217 and for 16 you have sludge transportation and disposal for $95,000 each year, and the last meeting that you said that those costs had tripled because money you wasn't taking it and everything else. Is this $95,000 inclusive of that tripling?
No. That's what it used to be.
So this budget of 760 is $180,000 low.
Yeah.
Well, approximately.
Can I interject at this point? I asked Kevin, and Kevin gave me the last 6 months of the sludge disposal cost. Four of the months were for Montague, two of the months were for Cranston, Rhode Island. I did some calculations on this sheet that I just handed out, and it came up with an average sludge disposal and average gallons for both plants. As of last night, the town signed a new contract with Franklin County Solid Waste District, which brought the dry ton cost to $350 per dry ton. It was $285. It also increased the Franklin County waste disposal percentage from 3 to 3.5. When I did the calculations, if we would have stayed with, could have stayed with Montague for a year, it was $65,000 based on the numbers that you, and I projected doubling the numbers because you gave me 6 months. So I doubled the numbers, and the 6 months were January, February, March, April, June.
Right.
So they covered a good.
Yeah, I tried to get the ones when school was in.
When school was in. So then I took those numbers and projected them onto the new contract we just signed. It gives a total cost of sludge disposal, and it doesn't include some of the polymers costs and other things like that. But sludge transportation costs $100,000. In the next fiscal, in 12 months. Not 160, 180,000, more than the 95.
Okay, that's what I was asking.
That's what I wanted to answer.
Yep.
Did you factor in disposal fees in addition to transportation? Because there's that too.
Whatever we had a bill for, I have the bills here.
Is what we paid.
It's what we paid.
Okay.
Yep, this is total cost.
Good.
So I felt that this would be helpful for the committee to review, and it clarifies some of the information we've been saying that the costs are 3 or 4 times as much. They're significantly, they're 53% increase over Montague, but it's not 300 times. I just wanted to.
Well, when you asked me that at that prior
meeting. No, I understand. I'm not saying anybody was wrong. I just wanted to do a clarification. Because I think we need, this is going to be a good projection. If the numbers run true, which you guys can check, it would be good for your budget. But you do have additional costs that will thicken the sludge with polymers and other things that we didn't use in the hauling, I didn't use in the hauling process. So that clarifies your first question.
Something caught my attention. Did you say that there is another place besides Cranston that they could go to?
No. Not that I'm aware of.
It was for a while, right?
Blackstone was.
Upper Blackstone. Upper Blackstone.
They keep changing the game, the rules, and I see it as very much trying to discourage Western Mass small treatment plants from delivering sludge to them because they just don't want it. Because all of our plants, most of our plants, don't have screening to get out the rags, and that's problematic for them. So their way to prohibit us from bringing it there is to make sure that it's so expensive no one will want to. So it's sort of a roundabout way of them excluding a large section of the state from, which I find shocking that they would rather have us take it to another state, and other states are getting a little tired of our stuff too.
I was going to say that I don't know this, but I kind of heard that the Cranston place might dry up as a source.
Yeah. One by one, everyone's doing it. Yeah. Because with only one game in town, it seems like every time someone says, okay, we'll take it, they get inundated with so much, and it becomes a traffic jam, and trucks are sitting there. I mean, from what I understand, Nunes had to pay their drivers hotel fees because the lines were so long that the drivers had to spend the night there. So there's all this overtime going on, all this. And meanwhile, we're just overwhelming Cranston with sludge. And they're getting up to here with it, and they're about ready to say.
But you did sign the contract with
Franklin
County to find, and it was at a certain price. So we're locked in with a price.
Right.
Wherever it goes.
Were we locked in last year because they raised the prices back in the spring, didn't they?
I believe it went from Montague was, dry tonnage was 310, and Cranston was 285.
Will it be cheaper when we get all the rags and sneakers out?
Can we bring it to other plants? That's
well, I think unfortunately, and I'll wait for Keith to come back to confirm this, but my general understanding is there was a lot of other plants that used to do it. And they were basically using an incinerator system, but because of no offense, Mark, the DEP issues that come up behind it as far as the regulation on how they're tightening it up, they don't want to pay the money to upgrade their stuff. It's not worth it to them. So
I have a question. 20, 25 years ago, did they not bury it in the landfill?
Yes.
Yeah, probably.
They did, but since we closed the landfill, we can't do it anymore.
Well, is the landfill totally closed? It's open for stumps.
Stumps, that's it. Stumps, you have to cover that stuff pretty soon.
And the other issue was, because originally they were allowing them to go ahead and put them on as capping material for landfills, like they do over Irving right there off of Route 2. Our copper content is too high. So that's why it's not allowed to be land-based anymore. And I'll check with Keith, but I believe that's
in the minutes. Okay.
But in Cranston, are they burning this stuff?
No. I don't know what they're doing with it, to be honest with you. I don't know if they've got the really big pools like what Montague did. I'm sure Keith can probably answer that question as soon as he gets back in.
I find it awful foolish that the state is making these mandates and they're not providing.
I agree.
An access to a service. I mean, how can the state mandate all these regulations and not provide an outlet?
Exactly. I feel the same way.
It's crazy.
I feel the same way.
Is it an unfunded mandate?
Basically.
Well, it's not. Well,
it's unfunded under 2.5. They have to pick up the cost.
Yeah. So I think the next question you have, is Cranston, do they burn there? Or do they do like the money you did? No, they don't have that. It's just an incinerator.
Incinerator? Okay. So it's an incinerator.
Okay. So if Cranston closed down, then where does it?
then we're...
Yeah, I don't know where...
Then we pay a lot of money.
And then what, and then is our contract with Franklin Council of Governments, is that what happens?
Redefine print.
It's not with the Franklin Council of Governments. It's with the Franklin Regional Solid Waste District.
Oh, that's right, I'm sorry.
And my experience thus far, no offense intended toward anyone, including Jan and me, she's a very personable, professional person, and she tries to do the best she can, but I don't really see a lot of bang for our buck with them. I mean, yeah, it's nice to have her figure out where it's gonna go next without us having to deal with all that, but beyond that, could we not process our own bills from Noonan or our hauler and from the disposal site? Have them invoice us instead of Franklin for 3.5%? Because my point here is, whenever we have had a place like Montague decide to shut down from accepting our sludge, and now we have more expensive options available, Franklin Regional Solid Waste District does not seem to really advocate that strongly to prevent that from happening. They just sort of throw their hands up and say, I don't know what to do, this is the new thing, we're all in the same boat together, it's going to be expensive and difficult, and it's going to be crazy for a while, but that's what we got to do. It's like, somebody else is dictating this, and I personally had expectations that for that money that we're giving them, that they would be a much more powerful advocacy on for our sludge hauling and everyone else in this area, instead of just taking the money to process our bills for us and say, I don't know what to do, this is the best we can do. And it's unfortunate, but there is no other place that are willing to accept it. I've talked to Jan recently, and she did say that she has called around and tried to find other people willing to accept sludge for all of us, but that's about all they can do is call and ask. And sort of hat in hand, you know, will you take our sludge? And if all they have to do is say no, and that's the end of it. So we're all stuck paying whatever it's going to cost to haul it wherever.
Next time you have a conversation with her, can you ask her if she looked into Brattleboro or Keene or any of the other large municipalities?
She lives in Brattleboro, I'm
to
sure
the north,
she probably has.
As to whether or not they would be interested in taking the stuff?
Yeah.
You know, you don't know unless you ask.
Right.
Just like you never get a discount unless you ask for it.
Sure.
Bruce? Oh,
okay. If we could, I'd like to stay on rate structure.
Yeah.
And I think the purpose of us discussing the rate structure is to come up with options, not to develop it currently. We have 18 months to work on this evaluation, what our charge is. Our charge was not to come up with a rate. Currently, it was to come up with what we propose to the Board of Selectmen as what we feel is the best option. So I think our discussion needs to be, what are the options for a rate, users' rates, an enterprise fund, fixed rate, flat rate, EDUs, EURs, all the options we need to discuss. And I think that would serve as better if we had that discussion rather than having a discussion on dollars and cents. Until we have a better idea, we have a presentation from the engineer on what is proposed. He received an email from me relative to presentation was supposedly December 7th or 8th of last year. That was not the full presentation. I think that because the numbers have changed and they're not being paid for, I think they're currently wanting to do it something else other than make a presentation to us relative to those numbers. So they didn't want the numbers out without having them say the numbers and have a question and answer. So what I emailed to you was a portion of that presentation. And was, it's just for reading, I didn't copy it, it's just for your information, because we had hoped to have a presentation tonight, and we still don't have a date yet, but...
No, it's going to be mid-September.
So, the first thing was that...
Can I back just...
Yeah, just options on the...
Just so you're aware, I have requested directly from FCAT, that meeting, and it was December 7th.
I requested it, too.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
Okay, well, maybe between the two of us, we'll get it.
I requested from Doug, Doug said he had it.
Right. I went right to FCAT. And Chris called me back on Monday, he said, yeah, I'll get there for you, he said, it's in archives, he says, I'm going to have to...
Okay, so what we were sent was December 8th, was what Weston Sampson sent?
What they sent?
Which I forwarded to you, it said December 8th.
Oh, December 8th, all right, so I'm off a day.
I just want to make sure.
Yeah, that's fine.
It was a portion of what the presentation...
So, whatever the presentation date was?
Yeah.
I'm looking for the video to try and get that video distributed here.
So, it's up to the chair, but I think options are what we've been talking about, relative to how the rate, because we have on the agenda...
Sure.
Talking about the rate, plan, so, the rate structure.
Just the floor is open, anybody, you know, come up with ideas?
Here I have in front of me, I should have made a copy of this, I have a study done by Black and Veatch, 2012, 2013, Black and Veatch, the engineering firm, of 50 largest cities' water, wastewater rate survey. And so here's some bullet points. 89% of these municipalities send a monthly bill. Why? So it's like your cable bill or your phone bill. Also because many people have trouble budgeting for, $500 twice a year. They can handle $40, $50, $60 a month or more, but that big dollar amount, that's what generates the angry phone calls, because people haven't budgeted for $500 or whatever. If we send a monthly bill, the costs increase because somebody's going to send the bill. There's going to be a process for...
And you got to know what their water use is.
Stuck with...
Well, although you could average it out.
If you want to average them, give them a rolling average, and at the end of the year, they do pay more or get a rebate,
That's what they did in Virginia where I lived.
Yeah.
They had wireless readings for water and sewer, wireless. Mm-hmm. And then I got a bill every month for water and sewer.
Well, actually, they have that in Northampton, and I've been called. One time, the Northampton Water Department called me, and they said, hey, you're using a lot of water. What's up? Well, we were really busy, and we were washing a lot of cars, but, they were on top of it, yeah. Mm-hmm. Was a pipe broken, or, was the toilet running, or...
Right.
And it's charge your sewer charge on it too?
Well, actually, I don't actually know. I don't pay that. My landlord pays that, but I don't. But in any case, they were just on top of it because they could see because they had this some kind of wireless system.
Yeah.
Yep.
So the water districts read the meters twice a year, and we receive the meter readings from the water districts, and we make the calculations here in house relative to the bills. So the average could work, but it would be an anticipated average. But I agree with you, a monthly bill is better than 6 months.
Maybe we could even go in the middle, do it every quarter.
In that study, there's quarterly bills.
The other thing is the town only bills it semi-annual on the real estate taxes. Now they could go to quarterly billing on the real estate tax and incorporate it all in one bill.
and that would help out dramatically.
Cash flow-wise.
I don't think you can. The Department of Revenue is very specific about your real estate bill, what can be put on it, what cannot, has to be approved.
Well, anyway, I'm just saying, it's something to think about.
It can be sent out in the same envelope.
Put it in the same envelope.
Well, there again, that's even debatable.
Really?
Is it?
The Department of Revenue is very specific when it comes to real estate bills.
Anyway.
But it's okay.
But I really think that we ought to be really concentrating on segregating the cost for the operation of both systems. So we have to actually have a handle on what it costs to operate each plant and therefore be able to determine what is probably a fair and equitable rate for the operation of that particular plant. Because you have separate sludge bills. The only thing you don't have separated is your laboratory costs, and that can be apportioned by a total usage. How much flow there is in Old Deerfield, how much there is in South Deerfield, and take those lab bills and break them down 15% in 85%. But then you could be able to segregate what it costs to run that plant up there, what it costs to run this one down here.
To what would be the purpose of that?
To try to determine what was fair and equitable for the rate and how the rates are determined.
So you would rather treat the town as separate pockets rather than
as the town? What I'm trying to say is you need to, we probably should have two separate districts.
I know, why? Doesn't that add
just so the costs are apportioned about the people that are actually using the stuff. The cost to run that system in Old Deerfield should be borne by the ratepayers.
Well, really, the users in Old Deerfield are very different than in South Deerfield. Yeah. And basically, they're three nonprofit institutions. And they don't pay property taxes. So any discussion of property tax users getting involved in paying for sewer plant upgrades, they're not going to participate in that. And they also have, well, for you, they present different problems. You said that it's much more difficult in the summer because the flow is
so low.
Is so low, yeah.
And then there are periodic spikes in the summer too, which adds even more complexity to it. Yeah.
Kevin.
Just keep in the back of your mind that could be a double-edged sword, because right now, collectively, everybody's paying the same thing. Now, let's just say hypothetically, we change the numbers around, and it costs so much more in South Deerfield than it does in Old Deerfield. So you know what? Their rate just got cut to $2 a thousand, and they just went to $75 a thousand.
Kevin, as long as it's fair and equitable.
That's what I'm getting at.
What I'm trying to say is if it's fair and equitable, nobody can sit there and complain.
True.
And that's what I'm trying to say is it needs to be fair and equitably distributed. I mean, I'm surprised that, you know, there was that huge cost up there to run that plant, especially with the repair of that line. That's a huge betterment that right. took place.
Well, that was an I&I thing. That was the whole reason why that had to be done, was because there was so much water infiltration in there. And basically what it was is that line that was going across the field, when they were going across the field, and no offense to people that were working the field, but they would accidentally hit the covers would come off, the rain would come, the flood would go into the sewer, and then the sewer system, or his plant, would go ahead and filter all that water that was in the thing. So now that has been repaired, and those catch basins are much higher, then we're not receiving all that water anymore, which is the whole idea behind the I&I.
Yeah.
Has conservation by eliminating 50% of the inflow raised the cost of operation to the plant?
Raised it?
Yeah, it's like when Oxford bailed out of Deerfield, they had to raise the rates because you have a bottom line cost.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So conservation to a certain degree boots you in the butt. So by cutting the inflow up there,
they did that as a collective inflow, though, not, it wasn't tied to any one house or institution.
Right.
It was all the flow coming into a pipe, and then from this point to the plant, there was enough I&I that it was jacking the flow
right.
from 100,000 to 300,000.
But did it dilute your chemical costs and things like that because it wasn't as concentrated? That you had to turn around, your cost of operation increased because
was the cost of operation less because it was diluted compared to?
No, absolutely not.
No.
No. In fact, it was more cost when it was diluted. because, for example, the influent pumps would come on two or three times as often using electricity to pump all that extra flow, when now they will be off much of the time because there's a greatly reduced flow. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, to a certain degree, yeah. Because you were saying you're having a lot of trouble now with the reduced flow. You know,
no, well, that's a every year thing.
Yeah.
When schools are out, that's the bulk of our flow. So, yeah, it's problematic in that you have to make drastic operational changes to accommodate the reduction in food for the microbes that do all the work. That's the deal. That's a seasonal thing that happens every single year.
Both plants?
No, at Old Deerfield. Only at Old Deerfield. This flow here is constant all the time. And the only thing that really affects it or impacts it is adverse weather or lack of rain. Like right now, we're at half what we normally are because of the drought.
So it goes back to the INI.
The INI is problematic, period. That's
because
yeah.
if your flow is down low now because we're so dry, mm-hmm. and when we get a lot of rain and the water table comes up, pipes are in the water table, inadvertently, and they suck up the water and goes into the pipes, and now we're treating it. So we're doing the same thing. So realistically, what's going to end up having to happen is there's going to be a lot of sewer mains, either they can be lined, replaced, or something, to be able to reduce this INI.
Bottom line, overall, more flow equals more cost, period. It really does. Generally speaking, more flow is more cost.
Since we're talking about Old Deerfield, I had a discussion with Brian Notowitz, the water superintendent of the old fire district, and asked him several questions. One, I wanted to know what his current water rate was. His maximum flow capacity was 200,000 gallons per day. His average daily use, approximately 38 million gallons per year. His monthly use, about 100,000 gallons, and that's what you see at you don't see that much at the plant. 100,000 gallons per day.
When schools are in, we do.
When schools are in. He said that they don't see a real change when schools are in or out of session because they water the playing fields. We're talking about water only.
Right.
So I asked him, did he believe that all residential, commercial, and private schools served by the municipal water system have water meters? He said yes, with one exception, Eagle Brook School. Eagle Brook School currently has its own wells for some of its properties. Kevin, you must have been up there the day before because he said you were.
He was asking
the same question. And he said it was very difficult, would be very difficult to establish the sewer flows because they're using private water, even though all their buildings are metered. He might have a better idea. And I think Kevin, in reviewing the options, and this is what he told me, that possibly we could put a mag meter on their outflow, and we could then meter their sewer. And that would give us a better understanding of what their use is. Currently, we do not know their use at Eagle Brook School. We have a good guess.
They're going by what they tell us on the meters. That's what it is.
Right. They read their own meters. They tell us what they are.
And that's how
we build that. So Eagle Brook needs to have some sort of solution looked at relative to our way of establishing rates.
Is there just one sewer line that comes from Eagle Brook to crosses Route 5?
Yeah, it comes right down the hill.
Is that a better place to put a
meter? Yep.
Yeah, definitely.
You need a nice 5 or 6, 7 foot stretch of flat.
You want to put it in right where the railroad goes underneath, because I think that's where there's a manhole right there, I believe, years ago. Someplace in that vicinity.
Yeah, so there's a couple places.
And there's no, other than that school, nobody else
Bobby
uses the sewer?
Well, check it years ago.
This is up county road, so technically you probably have maybe two residents.
There's a couple of residents. So he said if you can catch it as soon as it comes out, it would be better. So the other question, and somebody asked, that I think, I want to say, John, did you ask whether they had special rates
in the water district?
No.
Somebody asked that question, it was in the meeting minutes, I'll have to review who it was. So I asked them if they had any special assessments for schools or any other use. And they said, no, not really, the only major abatement that they do allow is for the Deerfield Academy chiller, because that uses a lot of water and it's just recycled. And so utilizing, they have, could be 1 million gallons a year that's being recycled out of their chiller.
If it's recycled?
That doesn't, wouldn't affect us as a sewer rate.
No, but if the water's recycled, do they need to how much of it gets lost?
Evaporated, there's very little that comes back in.
So it should be a real wash then?
No, I don't think it is. Not according to Brian, he felt that they do issue an abatement to Deerfield Academy, and that's the only abatement they allow, and it's for the chiller, and he's done calculations with their engineers. So it's just a minor point. It's just to say that all the water used at Deerfield Academy is not something we can sewer. So we have to come up with an alternative way to figure rate, how we establish a rate for schools. So maybe it's using EDUs or equal equivalent units to residential. Actually, the water district, when I said that, he says to me, well, yes, we had to determine a fair and equitable method for all the users in Old Deerfield when we had some major capital improvements. We didn't want to increase the rate. The rate we felt wasn't something we could justify because of the abatements and different times of the year. And so what they came up with, and they hired an engineer out of Vermont, and they came up with equivalent residential unit for their capital improvement loan payments, just for the loan payments themselves. And that's a fairly good way of thinking about it, that we look at options to use an EDU or an ERU as an equivalent. And it's based on water uses, but there's some calculations that are done. They charge 33 EURs per 100 cubic feet of water used to repay the SRF loan. And what they found, that was more money than they needed in the first few years. And they have excess funds, and they take the excess funds and they put it in a capital improvement account. So they're creating a capital improvement fund by using EURs. So that's an option that we should be looking at. I mean, we should bring this to David Pritchett to look at as an option to pay for capital improvements. We could do EDUs throughout the town. I passed out something a couple of weeks ago relative to EDUs based on schools, and it was from another community out of state. And it has its merits and it has its downfalls, but it's definitely a method where you would not be increasing the user rate so drastically, up to $40, but you can keep that variable increase as the O&M goes up, but have a standard fee
just for capital.
That's
a phenomenal idea.
My question is, this is just for the residential users. Did the others kick in money towards that capital improvement?
Yes, so they established what an EUR was for each user.
Okay.
The school might have been 300 EURs.
Okay.
The average was 33, is what he told me.
Yeah, for the residential.
For the residential. And then schools, he didn't give me that number because he didn't have the paper in front of him, but he remembered what it was.
Well, they might have just kicked up so much money, each one of them.
As an example,
come
I think
to a discussion and come up with a
when
number.
I did the study 2 or 3 weeks ago, Deerfield Academy was like 270.
He may not have this.
Oh, he might not have.
Maybe I got it. I don't know.
So, based on one equivalent household, Deerfield Academy was 270 household units.
Okay.
So, I mean, but you would need somebody to establish, we can't, I don't think we as a group can come up with that number, but since we're paying for a rate study, we possibly can add that or include that in what his evaluations were, because he said, this is really just a start. And so that's an option, and I thought it was important.
So does an institution with nonprofit status, do they?
Yes, they can be charged. They have nothing to do with it.
Is property taxes only.
They're just going to put it on as a water charge.
Would they consider that, could they make the argument that?
No.
What you're suggesting was in fact property tax, was in fact a tax?
No, it's a user fee based on equivalent residential rates, basically. Residential user rate. It's an equivalent use. And there's all kinds of formulas out there that can be used. And it is legal, found in several cases that it has been upheld, and specifically DOR allows it. Just to keep on the rates portion, that's why I did that with Old Deerfield, because we had some concern relative to, are all the users paying their fair share? And Brian believes all are, but he can't qualify Eagle Brook's.
Right.
But there's nobody up there with, other than Eagle Brook, that's pumping it, getting water from another source other than the Deerfield Water Fire District.
How have we thus far?
Domestic water.
Domestic water.
Domestic water. Deerfield Academy does have pumps.
Yeah.
They do have those dry hydrants located all over.
And do water.
Which is what they water their lawns with and stuff like that.
Yeah.
I've seen.
So potable domestic water.
Right.
Which will supply to Deerfield Academy through the water district. There is no crossover.
For Deerfield Academy, yeah, Deerfield Academy.
Correct.
Were you asking Eagle Brook or Deerfield Academy?
No, Deerfield Academy. There's no cross-contamination or anything else.
No, there's, they can't.
The systems aren't mixed.
There's no pipes that connect.
How has Eagle Brook thus far been built? Based on?
Going off of what they say that they're using for.
Educated guess.
So if they're going through and I would like to think that they're doing the right thing and actually telling us what the actual numbers are, then they've been paying their fair share all along.
Right.
And has the numbers crept upward?
I can't tell you.
No, I just wondered.
We have the ability to verify. Mm-hmm. And I think at a very inexpensive cost, you could do several periods of time during the year when school's in, and you could do when it's out, so you have some relationship.
So if he's got the water district figures here, what's going through the sewer plant? Twice as much?
He said, what you said, how much is going through Old Deerfield?
When schools are in now, since the INI project was completed, on average, 100,000 a month.
That's pretty much his monthly usage.
Yeah.
So that's pretty close. But he doesn't supply all the water. He does supply some water to Eagle Brook.
I mean, 100,000 a day, excuse me.
A day, right.
Yeah.
Gallons per day, GPM. So, I mean, it's just something to look at. It's nothing that's critical, but we asked the question in one of our meetings whether or not all the ratepayers were included. And with the question asked about any fees, special fees being charged at South Deerfield Water District, it posed me to make the phone call.
One thing about this mag meter. We tried putting a meter on there, I would say probably 15 years or so ago. And the meter readings that we got were so high, we had to discount them. And I don't know if it was because
this was at Eagle Brook?
Eagle Brook.
So it was
when
tried.
The water was coming down, I don't know if the water was getting in from the brook into one of the manholes. And then there's a question of how many manholes up there and how much of that is private manholes and how much of it is public manholes. And I'm not sure if there's a breakdown up there or not.
Do you know if you put the meter close? How close to the building?
You can put it right at the building.
Right at it.
It was in one of the manholes.
As soon as, when all the connection is.
That's where we had the meter. And the thing came back like 5 or 10 times what we expected.
Wow.
And that's why we had to discount the thing, and we never used it again after that.
Is the meter still in there?
No.
No, because it was a rental through Weston and Sampson.
Okay.
Fast.
So, I mean, yes, I mean.
Okay, so I think this is on the.
Rates?
Back to my bullet points here.
Yeah.
And so, according to this, only 13% of these top 50 cities have sewer rates based on actual water use. So.
When I read the study.
So this would eliminate this issue of who, you know, how much water is being used and how much is. And also, it would make a monthly bill easier because you would.
Because they're going by EDUs.
Right, so you know exactly how much the annual bill is. And you,
so $100 a month,
like that too.
Right?
Well, they
would come up to your per household unit, would come up to the number that you are supposed to hit for that USDA money? Close to it?
Well, it'd be less than a. Yeah. Be less than 100 a month. What's 700 divided by?
Well, but you can't use that 700. I don't think. I don't think we can use the average bill in the calculation to make 1%.
So if you,
well, the median, it was 1% of the median income, whatever that was.
Yeah, right. But then you
per
can't.
Per year.
I don't think you can project that to a residential unit, though, one household, because you have industry, you have commercial, you have, that use a lot more water than a resident. Hotels that use a lot more water than one household. And I think what they look at is the total.
Well, that's a good question. How do they come up with a bill for all these different users?
That's,
and
there is a method.
Without basing it on water use.
Basically, what we were trying to do is we were looking at. Again, it's basically setting up your EDUs. Presently right now, what we do is we're utilizing the Title V calculator, for like a regular septic system. And they go through and the system that we have is there's a drop-down bar. You go ahead and click on that and it asks, is it a single family home? How many people are in the home? Is it a gas station? Is it a hotel? Is it this? Is it that? Is it an institution? Do they have a gym? Do they not have a gym? Do they have showers? Do they have, all the things. There's like, I hate to exaggerate, but there's probably going to be at least 15 or 20 options. So you go ahead and click on that. And then that, in turn, will generate how many gallons per day.
Right, average
gallons. That they would be utilizing, which is kind of the idea on how they're trying to go with the EDUs or going on that theory.
Can that be used on for any type of occupancy?
Yes.
Industrial hotel?
Yeah, yes.
They're all included.
I don't know how extensive it is, but it's
really extensive.
Very extensive.
Develop something yourself off of that to give us an idea.
You have the Title V with you, don't you?
Because that would, the sheet that would also offset any people conserving. You would have to raise your rates.
Exactly.
On two ends, on the sewer,
right,
as well as the water department. Conserve too much there, then they're going to have to raise their rates as well.
Right.
So.
Which is basically what ended up happening, my understanding is at one point in time, is all of a sudden the rate went up a little bit, and when the rate went up, then they noticed that the flows went down. It was because people were conserving even more, which is great, because you're trying to conserve the water, but unfortunately that doesn't jive to be able to pay your bills.
That also, too much conservation, this goes right back to what you're saying, it's too little flow to begin with, so now you have to do something to offset the limited flow.
Mm-hmm. Which in turn makes it difficult for me with
the
collection system.
So the EDU type of situation would eliminate that
right
layer.
Yes.
Right.
I think it's an option we should.
Could we get the guy who's doing the study to give us the sample EDUs and what he would calculate for all the EDUs for all the businesses in town and all the residences and see what that would come up and what kind of income that would generate.
Yeah.
I'd really like to see...
The generation of the income on an EDO is you base it on your budget.
Yes.
You've got, you'll end up in the town having 3,500 EDUs. And you divide that by your budget...
$350,000.
Whatever it is. So then each person pays their allocation on an EDU.
What I'm saying is that you pass out this thing about EDUs.
Yep.
But, and it tells methodically exactly how they get them, and that all makes sense. But we've never taken it one step further, which is to turn around and say...
I agree.
How much money will we generate based upon these?
We can generate as much as we want.
But it's got to be fair and equitable.
But it has to be fair and equitable.
And we also got to, I think, make one more step and say, how's that compared to the average bill, too?
But the other thing is, I really think that we should be looking at segregating the cost between the two plants so that we actually get a handle on what it is. And, yeah, maybe we'll pay more in South Deerfield, maybe we won't, but it's got to be fair and equitable.
But I think the EDUs is the way to resolve that. You're not dealing with water usage, you're not dealing with cost at the plant.
And what you are when it comes time to the...
But we don't track the cost at the plant.
Well, that's what I'm saying, we probably should.
I don't know if even...
These costs for the sludge and stuff?
Yeah, I mean, there's one haul out of Deerfield and six or seven out of South Deerfield.
To do that.
Yeah.
So just taking that...
Well, it's about 14-15% for Old Deerfield and 85% the other way.
Exactly. So the total cost of the budget should be 14% for Old Deerfield and 85% for Deerfield? No. I don't think that's a way of measuring it, but we can disagree.
Without looking at the whole, you can't really tell.
Understood. I don't know if it's possible to look at the whole without having different accounting timesheets.
It would be if we had one plant for the whole town.
Right.
That would be simple. But again...
$34 million to build it.
Segregating is complexity. Complexity equals higher cost.
Right.
Somebody's got to do all this work. That costs money. Somebody's got to do all of that, and the billing is extra cost. You know, on and on it goes. The more complex you make it, the more expensive it gets.
It's pretty simple with the accounting systems that people have. You just create a sub-account, and it can segregate the one for Old Deerfield and the one for South Deerfield, and it can all be done...
Well, then you just take it another step further and go by income. People who make the most pay the most. That's another way to do it.
Trust fund income, right?
I mean, yeah, it went over with fanfare, I'm sure.
So...
Continue, Jack.
Is everyone totally opposed to the idea of hooking the Old Deerfield plant to Greenfield? I keep talking about this, and I don't get any positive...
I don't really think it's cost effective.
I don't think it's feasible.
Well, Greenfield is...
Oh, really?
Nice.
Well, I mean, is it worth exploring?
I think we need to have the engineers...
Well, there was some conversation about, even if we did that, the town of Deerfield is still liable for a certain obligation. So if, say, Greenfield needs to do a huge improvement of some sort, it would kind of be like South County EMS in reverse. They would just kind of come to Deerfield and say, this is your portion, and now what do we do?
These are your EDUs.
I think it's possible.
So you think it's too complex to...
I don't know.
Too complex and too difficult to, and too treacherous to...
If you got a great big federal grant to pay for all of it, yeah, fine. But if we got to pay for it, I don't know that it's going to work.
Well, you could always have it set up so that Greenfield would have to agree that Deerfield, the town of Deerfield, would no longer be liable for anything once they took it over, and have it all codified and contractual.
We could sell them the sewer lines, right?
Pardon me?
We could sell them the sewer lines, and they could bill the people directly.
Well, and...
We're getting off subject.
We could set the ground rules. For example, incorporating incorporating that, that we're not responsible for anything.
Once you take it over?
Once we hook up our line to you, it's yours.
Except that all the sewer lines would be on, the majority of the sewer lines would be in the town of Deerfield.
Okay, so we would still have to maintain the line itself, let's say.
We would have no revenue to do that with.
Exactly.
Well, we'd have to, it would have to come from...
Can you get a check from Greenfield?
No, no, it would have to...
Yeah.
Okay, so...
I know as well...
I'm not saying that it's necessarily easy, but what I am saying is that we could set the ground, we could agree on what the ground rules would be.
Why do you think Greenfield wants it so bad?
I don't know. I don't know that they do want it so bad, do they?
We haven't, nobody's really told us.
The mayor told me that he was willing to talk with Carolyn about it.
Who told you?
The mayor. He says he's interested in talking about it.
Well, they have more capacity, don't they, than they have...
Yeah, theirs has its own issues, though. Like flooding every spring.
Yeah.
Isn't that plant flooding constantly?
Every spring.
It's a mess, I mean...
And do they, and they have to do some kind of upgrade to...
And we'd be responsible for some of that liability.
So why do we even have a plant there?
Everybody does. Everybody wants to...
I think we're better off taking care of our own. We know what our problems are.
Bring it here.
Rather than signing on to a bigger city that you're going to have to turn around and share some of the responsibility with.
Yeah.
All right, let's get back to the study then.
Okay, so that's got dead issues.
I think, to be honest, I really think it's a future discussion.
Okay.
I think if we look at options for rates, because we, like you said earlier, somebody said earlier, we really don't know what the town wants to do for capital improvements. We have no idea. So any discussion we have to that is really just our best guess or an opinion, and it really doesn't get us anywhere. So I think our task is really to come up with some options, like the study did, because we want to bring him back in and look at other items and potentially maybe look at a split rate if we're going to go with rates for the use, and then for capital improvements we use EDUs, or we use EDUs for the entire billing process. Those are the things I think we should have further discussion relative to the rates. I thought about it, and maybe any improvements made in Old Deerfield, they'd be charged a betterment for all the improvements in Old Deerfield. That would be run all the sewer lines to the South Deerfield plant and decommission the Old Deerfield plant. That's for their benefit. It's not for the South Deerfield users' benefit. So betterments are an option, too. And betterments are not considered a tax.
It's not really a betterment for them, though, really.
Huh?
It's not really a betterment for them, though.
Well, it's a betterment that they had a treatment plant, and now, instead of having a treatment plant, we're pumping it to another, to Deerfield. You're right, it might not be a benefit, but it's a point of discussion we might want to have.
Yeah.
Maybe replacing, doing something with the public buildings. They can become EDUs, so they should be, improvements can also be considered as a minimum payment by the non-users of the sewage treatment plant. They can be a 0.3 EDU to pay for capital improvements.
Is part of the EDU calculation based on average per capita?
No. Nothing to do with dollars. It's all on...
Average water use per capita.
Not
per person.
Yes.
Okay. And was that a nationwide figure or local, regional, state?
The numbers that I pulled were from, I believe, Ohio.
Mm-hmm.
And I haven't done a great deal of research because we have somebody that can do that for us, and we don't have the information to make any other evaluation. All I did was come up with an option.
Right, right.
I'm not evaluating the option.
I'm wondering, because when I was in apprenticeship school with Hampton Roads Sanitation District, formal classroom training, I learned that the average nationwide was 180 gallons per person per day.
When I shared that with
a wastewater manager from New Hampshire at a training session, here in Massachusetts, he balked at that and said, I don't know where they're getting this from, because that's way more than it would be in New Hampshire. So everybody's kind of all over the map with, and they're basing it generally when they hear that on their own use.
So that's why Title V is important, because it's an average use.
Yeah.
And we'd base it on something that was a standard, to make it equitable and fair and equitable. And that, but I believe the average use in the study was 158 gallons per day.
Close, yeah.
Per person. And, but that's...
Well, it was 180 cubic feet, I believe, or the gallon equivalent, so maybe that's where that came from, but, so it sounds like it's largely unchanged.
I think
they're still using,
correct. But it is based on a gallonage.
That's good.
No, it is.
Really good, because that way...
And Title V gives you
standards,
which are very high. I mean, it's 110 gallons per bedroom per household.
Right.
So at that rate, if you had a four-bedroom house, it's 440 gallons a day.
Yeah.
And we're saying our average use is 158 for residential. I think that's what the report said. So, I mean...
Well, just to throw it out, I mean, my last year, I averaged 50 gallons a day for two people.
Yeah. And I'm about the same for water use.
I personally liked Jack's, you know, idea about a monthly bill or somewhere close to that, because I think people do have an easier time making a monthly payment than, you know, coming up with a large amount. You know, I personally, you know, don't like that, only because I hate using all the stamps and stuff, but I think that is a good way of, you know, getting people to, you know, get over the hurdle of a larger bill. I also like the fact, or would be more interested in listening to Mr. Prickett and more info on the EDUs and stuff like that. I can see where it's not going to be fair to some people who would conserve, but in the overall scheme of things, I think it might be an easier way of doing it. And I don't know if you penalize people who really want to conserve just to make something easier. I don't know, but I think it's something to, you know, get a little more information, and he can give us that breakdown. And then we can also look at it and see how that might apply to, you know, separating it from residential use to commercial use and industrial and institutional. We might find that the EDU comparison to like Deerfield Academy, I don't necessarily know how many kids go there. Is it
500 kids? They count staff. They count workers.
So, if you do it, you know, you might find that, you know, the school really adds up to, you know, a lot more than the houses if they were individuals. So, you know, they might end up paying more.
Understood.
Yeah.
It'd be an institutional rate, a commercial rate, an industrial rate, based on some standard of use.
Right.
Not on actual use.
Right. And that's what I'm saying. Like,
so that way we don't rely on two water districts to give us numbers, and a school.
Yeah. And only that, if people do conserve, if everyone conserved a lot more, you'd still have to raise the rate to make the money you need.
Right, exactly.
And that's the whole thing behind it.
I mean, you establish an EDU, then you establish a variable rate to go with it. Yeah.
Right.
650 students.
Yeah. That was the last one I got, too.
Yeah,
and plus staff.
And plus staff.
Like,
I think
1,200,
I think. It was pretty high.
Close to it.
On the numbers that I had.
Bruce.
Well, one of the things we keep talking about is EDUs. Let's not get thrown into that mix if you're going to ask Mr. Pritchard to work on something. Is a value to the town, because most of the commercial and industry that is here is here because of the sewer system. And they pay, right now, it's about 23-24% of the taxes that are in this town. So that there has to be, I personally feel, is a value for every person, every individual in this town to have this industry and commercial. And so therefore, there should be, at least for capital improvements, some sort of input from the town. As well, for the capital.
That's what HAPCO's doing right now, when they're doing their large don't remember what the million-dollar amount was, but it's extremely large.
Who's this?
And that is being...
Hatfield.
Put out, Hatfield is being put out to all of, everyone in town, whether you're on sewer or not.
Their rate is, for capital improvements, is townwide.
Correct. For capital improvement.
For capital improvements only. I mean, well, and that's another option, whether we...
We have a bylaw that says only users.
I know, but that, you can always change the bylaw.
But that would kind of change.
The commercial industrial is a huge benefit to this town, and they are here because of the sewer.
Yep.
The low taxes.
But...
I would like to comment on that.
You know, Hatfield, what I was going to say is Hatfield has much lower taxes than Deerfield.
Yes, they do.
And I don't know, I was never involved in any of it, but I sure have seen Hatfield's industrial base grow a lot over the last 20 years compared to Deerfield's. And part of it is Deerfield, there's a lot of stumbling blocks in our town, and there's not a lot of places left to develop, you know, and that's good and bad. So, you know, I think that it is important that, you know, everybody bear the burden of, you know, the sewer system, but not get too, I don't know if we'd get crazy over it, is that there's not a whole lot of development area left in town anyways. So, you know...
I think one of the things you have to look at is, what is your total tax stab from real estate? And for last year, it was like $10,063,000 or something. That's the total tax stab. Of that, $2.2 million is for industrial and commercial use. So what happens is, that money has been used for years to subsidize the tax rate for all the homeowners. Because the homeowners get a lot more for services than they pay in taxes.
Definitely.
And somebody subsidizes them. The subsidizing comes from the industry and the commercial users.
Yes, it does.
And if you would like to see some information, I did a little research, and I found, I was saying before, what the cost of community service ratio was. Well, I had to keep checking. Finally, I found, when I went down to the place in by Kulich building down here, CISA, I asked about the cost of community service ratio, and they didn't know what I was talking about. They said, wait a minute, we have one old woman that works in our office, but she's coming in tomorrow, and I'll ask her. So she called me up and says, yep, it's the cost of community service ratio, and it was done by the American Farmland Trust. So they called American Farmland Trust, and they did two studies in Deerfield. The if you go onto the internet, you can get this 6-page booklet, and the first page and last page explains all about the thing, how the system works, and the rest of the information on the inside is by state and by town. They've done two studies for the town of Deerfield. The first one was done in 1992. There's a joint study between American Farmland Trust and the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. And the figures that they came up with from 1992, the 1992 study covered three towns in the state. One was Agawam, one was Deerfield, and one was Gill. And I don't care about the other two, but the bottom line is that study showed that the median cost of community services for that was commercial industrial got 29 cents of value for each dollar they spend in taxes. Working in open land, they got 35 cents in value for every dollar they spent. And every resident got $1.16 for every value that they get. Now, recognizing this, and especially that the commercial industrial users came here for it, and I'll give you a couple of examples. Right across the street, Berkshire Brew Company. I can remember when we were sitting over, I don't know if it was in this building or the old building, and they came and made a presentation. And they said, look, we've gone to Springfield first, and they threw us out. And then we went to Greenfield, and they threw us out. So we're here to make a presentation to you, and we hope you don't throw us out. They want to start a small brewery business, but they said they had to be on a sewer system. And after they gave us a presentation, I said, throw you out. I said, I'd like to welcome you to Deerfield. So I made a motion that we authorize them the direct connection for that building into the sewer. Now, since that, they've stayed here and they've grown. Last year, they contributed over $23,500 in taxes between real estate and taxes to the, for their truck registrations and excise tax. Now, if you take a look at Channing Beach, they came into Deerfield. Why'd they come in? Because they could have sewer here. And when they came in, they paid for their own railroad crossing to get the sewer underneath the railroad crossing just to tie into our sewer. When Yankee Candle up there on 5 and 10 came down, they built a warehouse first, and the warehouse had a humongous septic system, and the thing failed, so they put in another one. And then since then, they put the main office building up there. When they built the main office building, Yankee Candle came to the town and wanted to put in a direct connection right into our sewer. And we said, yes, they could, but it was at no cost to the town of Deerfield. So they did the engineering and they paid for the line to go all the way from that building, all the way down through, past where the animal hospital now is. The animal hospital has since tied into there. They went all the way down across from the fire station and underneath Route 5 and 10 to tie into our sewer system. People in this town, the commercial industrial, are here for a reason. The reason they're here is because they want the sewer. They're not here because we got nice open field. They could have done it up in Conway. They could have done it in Hatfield. They could have done it anywhere. But the people that wanted to be here because of the sewer, and they need the sewer. Now, since they generate $2 million and over $2 million, or pay $2 million in taxes, why don't we use some of that money to subsidize these improvements that we want to get? Now, that's my solution to the problem. Now, there's a counter viewpoint that Jeff would like to tell you, and I have no problem listening to Jeff. Because, you know, I think this may be a scenario of what we did with the sump pumps in town. When we had too many sump pumps in town all pumping into the system, we authorized a $500 expenditure to get the sump pumps off the system. They had to be off by a certain date, and if anybody brought the bills in, if they wanted to do it themselves or whatever, we'd pay up to $500. And we got the majority out. Now, did they all come out? Hell no. I know that because I used to go out and check some of them, and I used to talk with the building commissioner all the time because he was in charge of that as a Board of Health improvement. Mm-hmm. But the bottom line is there is money there. There's money that can be used, but the bottom line is there's no way to segregate it. What happens is that $2 million in taxes goes right into the tax, and everybody votes on it. That's the issue. The issue is that we should turn around and generate and take and say, use the excuse that we're going to use $250,000 or $500,000 a year to go into sewer stabilization, to start paying for infrastructure. Because if you get $500,000 per year, over 10 years, you get a lot of money. Now, if you turn around and add in the fact that the town of Deerfield, town buildings have never paid any sewer tax ever, that I know. And if you take what was projected for the what they can generate for tax, sewer tax over this year alone or next year, and go back just to 15 years when somebody passed a bylaw which says that we can't charge the septic tank users for any of the charges to the town. The bottom line is that we've given the town more services, and we paid more services as individuals to the sewer system. Mm-hmm. Another point I'd like to make is the NPDES permit. That's the National Pollution Discharge Elimination System permit. Has an owner. Guess who the owner is? It's the town of Deerfield. It's not the sewer users of the town of Deerfield. It is the town of Deerfield. If it fails to do the job, the town of Deerfield gets fined, not the sewer user. That bylaw that was passed was a hooray for me and a hell with you attitude, and that was wrong. The bottom line was nobody really did their homework when it came up. It was something that just went through. It sounded good at the time, and a majority of people in this town are not on the sewer. So it passed overwhelmingly. But the bottom line is, now our back is against the wall, and either we're going to fix the system or we're not going to. We've already started to move in that direction to fix the system. We know we have to raise the rates, we're going to raise the rates. You're going to get a lot of grief, not me, you guys. Oh, he's gone.
He'll be back.
He'll be back.
Okay, I want to make sure you know and warn you that you're going to take a lot of grief from this.
I'm getting used to it quick.
I know. That's why you got into office, because you've got big shoulders.
Yeah, I don't know, George. Say, look at me.
Now, if anybody would like to see this report, I got a lot more I can tell you on it. This is the only copy that's left of the 1990 study. I just happened to call, and I said, I'm going to call the American Farmland Trust. So I called them, and they said, for the Northeast region, push 3 or something. So I pushed 3. Then I got a copy, left a message, and a guy called me back. And I still don't know who the guy is, but I wired his house in Asheville 20-something years ago.
Huh.
He knew my name. And after I talked to him, he explained to me all about this, and there's a 40-page book in here about the 1990 study. He says, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to give you the only book left that I know that we have. And it's right here. It's the only book that's left. And he gave it to me just because I wired his house 20-something years ago. Now, if anybody wants to take this, I'll be glad to give it to you. I'd just like to get it back.
Why don't you get it scanned? See if somebody can scan it.
PDF. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Actually, give it to the...
Give it to the chairman. He can give it to the town hall.
Right.
They can do that for us.
They scanned stuff for me, which I'll be handing out later tonight. So
what would you like to scan, the entire book?
There's two reports there. There's one from 2010 and one there from 1990. But it is good and interesting reading. And I'm glad that we got this good information. And it should provide a basis for us to say, who is getting the benefit from all the money in town, and where's the money coming from? And this shows you the value of people putting taxes into town, and they're not getting their fair share, and other people are voting and saying, yeah, I want this and I want that, and they're overspending, and the other people are subsidizing them.
So this report,
it's a cost of community service report.
But it looked at how many communities have the same issue as Deerfield?
All of them?
The 1990 study covers 3
understood.
From Massachusetts.
But other states.
Since 2010, there's probably 4 pages from every other state in the country.
Yeah.
It was developed pretty much for open space.
That's what I thought.
Right.
That was the emphasis of the booklet.
Before, okay. Do you want this entire thing copied?
I think it would be good for anybody who wants it. I don't know how many people want it.
All right, I'll ask them.
If you PDF it.
Puts it on PDF, everybody can access it.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Then we can
all right. Yeah.
All right. Scan it.
The only thing I want to do is
email
get it back
it to everybody.
I won't give it to anybody except for
so John,
one of those
I think,
two offices.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead. Jeff.
Very quickly. What John said, a lot of it is true. I think we all realize there's some value as far as industry in that and in the town. I don't think all the industry moved here just for the sole fact of we had sewer. I think location had a huge part to do with it too, as far as transportation of goods and so on and so forth. Also, we run into a situation of we seem to be ignoring the fact of the cost of the septic systems that were initially installed and the cost of the maintenance and the cost of Title V's at some point down the road when those systems fail. And that's falling on the individual homeowners. And all the other townspeople are not going to be sharing that cost. So, you take a look at a septic system now, and you're looking at $20,000, $25,000 for replacement, depending on soil conditions and that, but pretty realistically. So you average that out over the years, and there's some, a fairly high dollar amount over those years that people have to set aside. Otherwise, at the end of that time period with that septic system, when it fails, they're facing a huge bill themselves. Also, you run into a situation where, you know, you say services and everybody service this and service that. I pay $5,000 in taxes every year, and I don't get anything for service, or very few services. I mean, fortunately, Kevin still plows my road, and, you know, the police are around, the ambulance around is good to have. But other than that, I don't receive any services, per se. In fact, with our landfill, I have to pay additional money. You know, when you talk about a $15 million budget, town budget, and I have to pay, and I'm paying $5,000 in taxes, and I have to pay additional for the landfill and the bags, and, you know, you're talking about services. Well, you know, I guess that kind of comes down to the individual and the use, so on and so forth. Is there value of what John was saying? Of course there is. There's no question about it. But I think we have to be very careful. We have to tread lightly there as far as us as a committee taking a serious look on that, and how do we go about assessing it and pointing it in the right direction as far as users and non-users. Also, you know, we talked about the Headworks project, and it's a crisis. And I agree, it needs to be addressed. But we've heard from Keith and Kevin time after time, part of the problem, a big part of the problem, is users that are online. I'm not trying to point fingers now, but users online are abusing the system. When I have my septic system, I'm very careful what I put down in my system, because I know there's an end cost here. So, you know, all of a sudden now, because people abuse the system, they're going to ask a non-user to be assessed for additional costs that for a service they're not going to use. And I understand the benefits. There's no question about it. As far as industry and, you know, the tax base and that, I understand that completely. But as I'm saying, as a committee, I think we have to tread real lightly on that and really take a good, hard look at that to come up with an assessment that, as Bob had said, is fair and equitable to everybody. So,
just Kevin.
Just a real quick second one, just to kind of tap onto what he said. Hypothetically, and this is a super hypothetical, so it's not being borne upon all of the tax people, it's borne upon our industry and our, what do you call it, but how we look at it is, and I'm going to throw arbitrary numbers out, somebody pays $100,000 in taxes. Well, you know what? $60,000 goes to the town and $40,000 goes to the thing. And then everybody's taxes go up because they're not getting that extra money, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So you're going to pay either way. So exactly. So hypothetically, you went with that scenario. So technically, the money's not coming from the non-users. It is an assessment fee from the commercial area, so that money is set off to a side, very specific too, but the town counts on that money coming in to set your tax rate. So once again, you can go through and you're pulling $40,000 or $100,000, well, that's $40,000 or $100,000 that now our total budget is gonna be shortfall. And the only way to make up that is to raise taxes. So, I mean, it's kind of the double-edged sword on how you want to look at it.
So it's saying the same thing.
Multiple ways,
right? Whether you take money from pot A or pot B, yeah, to pay something, everybody's paying into pot A and pot B.
Right.
But at the end of the day, when my septic system fails, everybody's not paying in
exactly
to my septic system
exactly
replacement. It's me.
Exactly.
That's correct. I think we... Is there any way we can get cost figures to find out what the average septic tank cost to install and then amortize this out over 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years. For example, when you install a septic system, you run a pipe out, it goes into a box, from there it goes into the tank, from there a distribution box, and distribution box out to things.
To the leach.
Usually
field.
The thing that fails at a leach field. And what happens is if people turn around, put in a disposal, that thing's gonna plug up like nothing. But if somebody doesn't put it in, I've seen systems last 20, 30, 40, 50 years.
Depend on soil conditions, that's right.
Yeah, depend on the soil.
And you have to maintain them.
And you gotta maintain them, you gotta pump them every two, 3 years.
It still comes down to what Jeff was saying.
Yep.
A septic system will last a tremendous amount of time. Inherently, they're designed to fail.
Yep.
However, it is abuse that makes them fail sooner rather than later.
Right.
So you can't amortize that over a period of time, because if you take somebody that's conscious, don't use the drain hose, don't pour grease, which is of course the worst possible thing, but everybody seems to think they can dump grease down here, and...
Because it's liquefied.
You know, if you blend that group into the responsible group, you're naturally going to shorten the length of the, and this is what we're running into.
But I've seen...
We're getting abuse into the system.
But what I'm saying is, if you've gotta amortize it somehow, like for example, you made the comment, Jeff, that when somebody has to pay for your system, it's gonna be you alone and not the townspeople. How long have you lived in your house?
Right now?
Yeah.
40 years.
How many times have you replaced a septic system?
I haven't yet.
Have you replaced up the,
Right, knock on wood, right.
Yeah. But you see, you're more conservative and you know how to run it.
Right.
And you did a good job.
Very conservative, and also pump it every couple of years, the whole nine yards, yes.
So what I'm saying is, let's look at maybe a compromise of saying, okay, if somebody pumps it every 2 years or 3 years, maybe we can authorize $200 every 3 years for all septic systems in town, based upon getting some money out of the, commercial industrial thing, and see what that would cost. You know, if there's part of the plant specification showed how many septic tanks there were in town. We could take those and figure out what that would cost. We authorize, say, a $200 payment every 3 years and figure out what that costs, and compare that to trying to get some money out of the commercial industrial use. I think, first of all, that would make me feel a lot more comfortable saying, okay, now I know we can get a dedicated pot of money out of the town. The thing we gotta do is we gotta get the three selectmen agreed to put it on town meeting warrant, and then they gotta agree to support it, and then we gotta get the finance committee to support it, and then we gotta turn around and get the people to support it. Well, if they support it, maybe that's a compromise that we need to get this thing through and get it working right. Because before I became a selectman, and I was always taught that all major improvements are carried by the town. All major changes to the septic system. Any line that's in the town road belongs to the town. It don't belong to me. Any...
Question, John. Why am I paying more than for to use the landfill? Why isn't everybody paying for it and have it free?
The same question could be said, why are we all paying for school taxes? Mm-hmm. And $3 out of every $4 go for school taxes, yeah. But I don't have any kids in school.
Yeah.
Why are the land taxes down here in town where we have town sewer higher than yours are?
Right.
Yeah. I mean, there's all the way around.
It just goes on. That's why I say we've got to really take a look at it.
It costs more to plow Hillside Road than it does North Main Street. And, you know, so I mean, you can go on forever.
Yeah, but nobody plows my road.
It
doesn't cost the town.
You have to pay waste management.
But guess what we get from Yankee Candle? The state plows theirs too.
Yep, I know.
I thought stickers were bad until the movement.
And yet they pay $550,000 in taxes.
I agree that we all should pay some share, but we can't make it like Keith said. The more complicated we make it, the more cost it's going to be to each individual user.
There's a simple solution then. Put in $500,000 a year into the budget and take it right out and just eliminate that bylaw that's in there that shouldn't have been in there.
That $500,000.
That's all the problem.
Then
that's simple.
No, John, I agree with you. Then you take that $500,000 and divide it by 5,000 people in town, and that's how much more money you have to pay for taxes. Per person.
Say that one again. You lost me.
You get $1 million taken out of our income, our revenues, and you got to set it aside. That revenue has to be made up by the 5,000 people in town. You take $1 million divided by 5,000
taxpayers. You got 5,000 total
people. I'm just talking people. If we've got a household of four, you're going to take four times.
Right. Yeah.
It's 20 grand.
It's 20 grand per person a year. I just don't see it.
20 grand per person.
2,000.
$2,000, sorry.
If you're looking for $250,000, $500,000, $500,000 to go.
I understand that, but it doesn't make, I mean, taking money from one pot to another pot doesn't do anything for us. We need to come up with.
It does one thing. It solves our problem in how to upgrade the sewer treatment plant that has not been upgraded, and it is a town responsibility.
But that means your taxes go up and my taxes.